Thank you for allowing me to give this presentation. I should say a little bit about myself, because in some ways I'm not a typical person within digital humanities, and that also is the reason why I ask questions as I do. I did my PhD in theoretical atomic physics. I've worked 15 years in libraries, and 1 year ago I actually changed and jumped into the university environment to work with digital humanities. And so I'll talk a little bit about what is DIGHUMLAB. The facts, it's a project. It's a 5-6 year project. It was a little bit delayed in getting started. It has, depending on whether you talk now or in a month's time, 6 or 5 partners. And the reason is that the State University Library and the Royal Library in Copenhagen are going to be merged. So we have the National Libraries into what's called the National Library of Denmark. So we have the National Libraries as partners, and then we have 4 universities. It is Aarhus University, the University of Copenhagen, South Danish University, and University of Aalborg. As I said, I entered this a year ago. I was part of it before, but as a representative from the library world. Now I'm actually in charge of it. We have 4 different themes. We have 2 around handling archived material. We have 1 around sort of semi-structured material, like Clarin. And we have 1 around behavioral observations. I'll return to this, so if this is not making sense, it hopefully will before I end the talk. It's not a very ambitious project. It's 6 million Danish kroner. That is less than 1 million euro a year. So, and including the in-kind, we are up at 1 million a year for 5 years. So it's not, I mean, as I say, it's not a huge project. And of course, the results fits that. One of the things I've worked with and what I've just managed and what is actually the topic of this talk is sustainability. I mean, when I entered, I had 1 year, there was 2 years left. I had 1 year to actually get some sustainability up and running. And I have achieved it. So we now have 5 years more paid by the deans, the universities, no external funding. Starting from 18, we'll have another 5 years. And some of the things I'm going to talk about, I mean, I have button the outline of my talk, is really some of the thoughts which has entered my head trying to get this sustainability up and running. First, I will actually start describing what DIGHUMLAB is, a community of communities. It's not a top-down, it really is a bottom-up activity. I also use the ecosystem metaphor, and I'm also actually trying to think what it means. And then I will talk about a bit about sustainability and the thoughts I've had. So first of all, I'll actually start with this, I mean, community of communities. In principle, this could be any topic. It doesn't need to be digital humanities. This is common sense. You have a research group. The research group has some research questions. They constitute some experts. They have groups. They help each other. They can answer. They have tutorials, workshops, and cases. And they have tools and data. So we have a number of these. So this is, in a sense, my entity. This is a community. And when I look at DIGHUMLAB, we have a community of communities. So at the moment, we have 6 different communities being part of DIGHUMLAB. And the idea is that each of these research groups comes with their bit. They come with their research questions. That's theirs. That's not part of DIGHUMLAB. They come with their experts. They come with their help desk. They come with their tutorials, their workshop, and their cases. And they come with their tools and data. And really, it's the 3 inner circles, which to me is DIGHUMLAB. So the DIGHUMLAB ecosystem is, in a sense, the things from these communities. It's experts, it's groups, it's help desk, it's tutorials, workshops, and cases, and tools and data, and these are linked. And in a popular speaking, I say, I don't want to show a tool without it's put in context. It should be inspirational. It's important that the tool is associated with descriptions of how to use the tool. There should be workshops associated with the tool. There should be online tutorials. And there should be a name you can actually ask. because I think that was one of the first things which I identified when I entered this area, was the importance of the human factor. No, I mean, I know that digital humanities is advanced at different levels across Europe. I would say the level, and I'll come back to that in Denmark, is very much, we have a few advanced users, and then the majority really are inexperienced and really need to be able to ask someone. They want the human dimension to this. So this is something which I formulated, and I mean, this became, I mean, sort of the core of what we are doing. And this is the reason why when I we had to formulate, well, we did it as a group, we had to formulate the mission, vision, and values for DIGHUMLAB. I mean, we really started out with a mission. That was, in a sense, given. I mean, it is that DIGHUMLAB's mission is to contribute to competence development, internationalization, and innovation through a national focus on digital humanities in research, education, and knowledge transfer. That was a mission I had inherited. One of the things which I did as one of the first things was actually to read a very good paper about why the American project Bamboo failed. There's a very good paper, I can recommend it for those who haven't read it. And one of the things which they identified was, actually it was a mix of different groups, which each had their own agenda, which each had their own vision, and really saw Bamboo as a source of funding and not of a collaboration. And one of the advices they gave was, I mean, make sure you have a clear vision and you have the gateholders in acceptance of that. So what we formulated as a vision, which is inconsistent with what I said just before, is that DIGHUMLAB is the preferred community for inspiration to research activities within digital humanities, recommendation to tools and data, and access to best practice and experts in Denmark. And I think we need all the components, and that's actually what's characterized DIGHUMLAB. We are talking about values like research-driven, sharing, accessibility, ethical, excellence, creativity, and sustainability. We, some stage, we say maybe we should also talk about the low barrier, because I think that is also a very important part of what DIGHUMLAB is. So that was sort of a bit about, it should be vision and not motion. Sorry about that. So this is really what it's about. What I'm going to do now is actually to give you a very short glimpse into what DIGHUMLAB actually works on, what are the material in it. So first of all, the data, as I said, we have national libraries as part of this, and therefore we actually have a lot of different sources of data. They can be split in born digital and born physical. The born digital is because we have a web archive being part of this. Radio and television now comes out in digital form. It used to come out in a physical form. And we have a lot of stuff which has been digitized, video material. We have a lot of newspapers. We have 1 million radio programs. We have 30 million of newspaper pages. I mean, we have a lot of material, which also means we have a lot of material for actually doing big data science and doing analysis. The other split we have is, in a sense, the archive versus the real world. Again, I mean, a lot of the archive stuff is one thing, but we actually also work on going out, I mean, harvesting Facebook, actually doing, going out, looking at Twitter, characterizing Twitter, going out, looking at laboratories where you have to put up cameras to study to get information about behavioral activities. So these are the data. The tools, I mean, I'll fall there in two groups. We have what are called tools and services, which comes out as being, for instance, workflow management systems. I mean, for instance, in Clarin, I mean, you don't have to go through every step. You can actually go through a number of steps if you want to get some analysis done. We have also the radio. I mean, we have a whole complete information system where you can search and annotate and do the analysis. And we also have workbenches here in form of the NetLab, which is actually the harvested web material in Denmark. Another thing we have are the labs. We have something called VILA, which is a virtual, it's a video research lab in Aalborg. And one of the things they actually work with is come up with advice on how to put up cameras and do the settings. If you want to do, this is an experiment about, this was actually done to find out how you could teach students to drive the truck. They also have it in classrooms, and of course, associated with that, there are a lot of ethical questions. So ethical questions comes up as being very important. And also we have the tools associated with actually doing the analysis. We can go up to 5 video streams where you actually do the analysis. And as I said, so these are things. As I said, tutorials and online course material is extremely important. So one of the tools being used is called Elam. And so they actually have, I mean, in a sense, a Lego. We have the wheel of YouTube. You have Lego showing how you actually use the tool. And there are a number of different ones. And we also have course material. This is in Danish, but it's about how to use the web archives. And then, as I said, and a very important aspect is actually ask the experts. And part of the sustainability is actually to make the deans pay to have experts being ready to answer questions from users, students, from other universities. So the DIGHUMLAB ecosystem. So this is going in. So these are all the ingredients in this. I mean, of course, one of the questions you can ask is what keeps the ecosystem alive? I mean, how do we create sustainability? And what shapes the evolution of the ecosystem? I'm not going to touch the last a lot, even though that's something which I've used a lot of time trying to think about. But the thing is that if you have an ecosystem, you also have to have a methodology for actually closing down initiatives which are not relevant. If this should be alive, everything is there, should be relevant. It's not a question of getting the biggest archive, it's a question of getting the most relevant archive of stuff. I mean, this is a very old drawing from the last millennium. I made it in the EU context, and it really is about sustainability. And I mean, one of the interesting things here is that you have, in a sense, you have your needs and you have your outcome. And it's that link which gives sustainability. But the needs are converted into goals. And of course, I mean, the right goals gives, in a sense, an indication of the relevance. You have the goals, you have resources, you have activities, and you get some immediate output. That is something about effectiveness, efficiency. But the thing is, the output in itself is not relevant. It's when it's combined or put into context that it becomes, I mean, really the results and the outcome. So I think what's very important is really to have, I mean, this view about what are the needs we address and what's the outcome and how can we create sustainability. And that was actually why I was so interested also before, because I think one of the big questions is how can we have social impact. I mean, how can we measure social impact? I mean, it's easy if, I mean, some of the digital humanities work with health systems. I mean, there it's, in a sense, it's easy to argue. But if I work with words, I mean, that's more difficult. So, I mean, some of them is really, I mean, I think the third one which is up there is employable students. I think that's one very important one. That the students are employable is an indication that what they have learned is considered as being relevant by the society. I think that, I mean, ensuring the human dimension of digital development, I think is very important, and I say is something which goes into a lot of stuff. So this is one sort of line of thought. Another line of thought. I was quite interested because I was going along this line and then I saw a presentation, The Decade in Digital Humanities, and there was two figures which I really catch my attention. The first one is, I mean, in a sense, the Gartner's hype curve. I mean, the fact that you create a lot of hype about something. And we have the peak of inflated expectation where everybody expects a lot, but I mean, where it's pretty difficult, I mean, where you talk a lot. Then you sort of go down, get to the throat of disillusion, and then you get the sort of the slope of enlightenment plateau of productivity. And her claim was actually that, I mean, digital humanities at the moment is the peak of inflated expectations. I'll comment on this. The other one is actually how many do we have doing this? And there, she was actually, I mean, I can see that in Denmark, this is from England. I mean, you still have few in humanities who actually work with digital humanities. So we are at a situation where we have, I mean, the early adopters. So in a sense, what this sort of combines to say is that we have an infrastructure with few users. I've asked in Clarin, I mean, they say they have a problem actually getting users. I've asked some of my colleagues in other centers, and some, I mean, it is really a problem. Of course, there are not that many in digital humanities, in humanities, but I mean, still. So I think one of the aims we have is really to find out, I mean, how can we get and stimulate an interest in digital humanities and increase the level of digital competence? And again, I mean, now this is a realization I've done in Denmark, I mean, stimulated by England, which to me is very advanced, and some of these people are extremely advanced. But it's something which we have thought a lot about. And so what I actually have done is, I mean, the figure you saw before with the research questions coming in, I think one of the things we need to get out is competence development. So, I mean, that's also something we are looking very much into and are working on trying to see how can we raise the competence for all members in digital humanities. And one of the things which is happening is that people within digital humanities actually go out and get 2 hours of course time when you teach history or when you teach literature or when you teach something else to try to tell the students that there are other research questions you can ask and address if you use the digital, if you have a digital component into this. And that seems to be gradually helping and creating awareness. The other thing we are doing is really to go out and try to attract the PhD students and arrange summer school to try to get, the PhD students at least to understand it. We are also trying to address the professors. By the 2 hours, they will be there as well and listen. But also, there are actually going to be now more structured competence develop activities because, I mean, it's considered that this is actually something you need to understand. You may not use it, you may use something else, but at least you should know what it is you are not using. The third line of thought really was stimulated by an article I read by some Norwegian fellows, Olaf Hendriksson and Bendik Bygstad. What they did was they analyzed 42 different infrastructures and tried to identify when would an infrastructure be successful and when would it not be successful. And what they found was that, I mean, they identified three parameters actually entering this. One was the innovation mechanism, where you have a self, where you sort of try to introduce innovation into your infrastructure, recombine things in a different manner, and develop new services. They had a mechanism they call adaptation, where you actually try to include more services, meaning more users will actually use this, and hopefully more resources will come into your infrastructure. And the last one they had was scalability, where you try to get new partners. And the interesting thing is, I mean, which of these were most important? And what they found out was that if you had just any of those as your mechanism for driving your infrastructure, then it was not successful. I mean, I don't know if you can see the colors, they should be red and green. I can hardly see them from here. But what I can tell you is that the adaptation, there are 2 out of 3 failed, or you say 1 out of 3 succeeded. If you have innovation as the main driver and the only driver, then half of them would be successful. And if you have scalability, there's actually 1, so you can't say anything other based on 1, but that failed. Then if you try to combine them, I mean, you can have both the adaptation and innovation or adaptation and scale. I mean, then if you have adaptation and innovation, then 2 out of 3 succeeded. If you had adaptation and scale, then you had all of them, 7 succeeded. And if you have all 3 components, then everybody succeeded. So, I mean, it's hard to say, well, I mean, you can't conclude anything on this. But one thing which, I mean, at least I sort of seem to say, is that it's very important to ensure that you have some scalability. You have to make it useful for the end user and not too fancy. I mean, it really is not the fanciness, it is the usefulness. Rather focus on a few things which you do well than try to encompass everything which you then just do on the surface. adjust to user demands and political signals, and initiate collaboration and attract projects. And these are actually some of the components which we are working with. I mean, one of the things which we are trying to do is actually to attract the main groups at the different universities and try to make them become one of these pies in our infrastructure. So the conclusion here, well, it's not a conclusion, this is really, I mean, work in progress. I mean, one is, I mean, it's important to have a clear common vision. You should share the same vision. It's, I mean, DIGHUMLAB is not a funding agency. We are trying to attract funds and match with that, but we are not a funding agency. It's extremely important to identify this, I mean, the needs and the outcome. I mean, where can we make a difference and try to articulate that towards those who are going to support us, I mean, in this case, the deans, the universities. Improve the general level of digital competence within humanities. Make employable students. And then the human touch to technological development. In order to be economically successful, it's important to make it useful, not too fancy, and really, I mean, all the time adjust to user needs. And as I said, I mean, one of the user needs we identified in Denmark was a human face. There have to be a person you can ask. And, I mean, initiate collaboration and attract projects. And then the last, which in a sense also links to these other ones, is create ownership. Identify the key people, get them on board. The way we have done it, I haven't talked about the organization, but I've created what's called a science board, which is actually part of what is required to find out where should we go and what should be stopped. I mean, we have activities where I think maybe they will not be there in 2 years, so we have to find out how do we terminate them. But I'm not a researcher. I need to ask the researcher, and they need to take ownership for that decision. It's important to appreciate and reuse material. I mean, what I really hate is not invented here, then it doesn't exist. I see that, I'm afraid, a lot. We have to, I mean, it may not be perfect, but it's better than nothing, and we shouldn't really start from scratch every single time. And then the last thing, and we heard a talk earlier, I think it's very important also with the outreach to get the politicians, I mean, to start to create an understanding of the importance of humanities for the technological development. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Yeah?
I thought it was very interesting, the forklift and the video. Nothing's more reified than a badly driven forklift coming at you. But it just occurs to me in terms of the curve, the lifespan, that, you know, a couple of years ago, creating for your video team, creating videos for tutorials of forklift driving was the thing to do. Now, with a 10 euro Google Cardboard headset, you can have an augmented reality tutorial. Before your project ends, the forklift will be driven by a kid in the control office using a PlayStation controller. How do you, in terms of sustainability, and I guess it most dramatically applies in terms of your video component, how are you planning for that sort of sudden technology change in and the relationship between that and the sustainability of your projects like that?
I mean, I totally agree with what you are saying. I mean, the work on, I mean, especially, well, everything needs to be constantly updated and maintained. And when I look at my sustainability budget, actually 80% of the budget is to actually, I mean, make sure that experts are free to answer questions, to update when tools get updated, and to update tutorials to reflect the situation. I should say that, I mean, the one about the truck, I mean, now this was an example. I mean, where it's used most is actually in classrooms, but I didn't have a picture with classrooms. And tutorials are very much about recommendations on A, what forms need to be signed by the parents of the students who are videotaped, how to put up and what kind of cameras to use for different kinds of situation, and then, of course, also afterwards, how do you do the analysis. But we have accommodated for the fact that things change and nothing is constant.
Okay, one more question there.
Thank you for this really great presentation, which I think talked about so many important issues. One thing that I wanted to ask, so you mentioned in your presentation that humanists in Denmark get 2 hours of paid time to learn about digital tools and to talk to students about that. So I wanted to...
I'll correct that. I talk too fast. I mean, I'm sorry about that.
I simply wanted to ask if you could clarify or expand on that. Did I understand that correctly?
So the system we have is that some of the early adopters can go out in a classroom and get, I mean, for instance, 2 hours in a semester where the professor teaches history, for instance, to talk about the potential of digital history. So that was the 2 hours. So that is actually just going into a classroom and have a talk. What we are paying and what some of the researchers are paid for is, I mean, up to 3 months a year, so that's 25% of the time, they should be available to answer questions from researchers who want to embark on research in this area. I mean, one of the places is, for instance, I mean, using the web archive material really require a lot, so there we also have money for actually having an IT developer helping them to get started. It can be, I mean, if you want to analyze markup text, you have to understand some of the issues and how you get the text into the right form. So you can actually then get to the group who are doing this and they will help you. So there are 2 different things. So one is actually to get, I mean, ordinary students inspired and open their view to the possibilities. And the other are those who are interested but don't have the knowledge to get started. So, I mean, it really is, I mean, to get them started, there would be resources for that.
Okay, thank you very much once again.